Hi, welcome to my free Java video course, lesson 5. My name is Markus Biel. I'm a software craftsman with 14 years of experience in Java. My goal is to teach you Java in the easiest possible way. Please send your feedback to info@markus-biel.com. Okay, let's recap what we learned so far. So, we have created a class Person. Here it starts with the opening curly brace and it ends with the closing curly brace. We had two constructors defined, one default constructor that does not have any parameter, and one constructor that has a name parameter. This is the equivalent of the instance variable here, and so that Java can differentiate between the parameter and the instance variable, we added this. And now, when someone calls the constructor, the given person name will be assigned just in time when the code is executed to our instance variable inside of the class, which is private, so it's not visible for a caller. We added a comment because for empty constructors, it's best practice to add a comment so that your colleagues know this was done on purpose, because often, I mean, when you have, for example, a method and it's empty, this could be a bug. So this way they will know you did this on purpose. I also shortly mentioned there are other types of comments, but this is kind of my strategy in this course to not give you too many options for the beginning. I mean, learning something new is already quite difficult, so I don't want to confuse you too much. This is the best practice anyway, so always use that kind of comment and sparsely use comments, really. A comment should not be a replacement for bad code. In 99% of the cases, it's better to create a method instead of a comment, but I'm going too much in details. We'll see this later on. Anyway, so we defined two methods. In lesson 4, we created this hello method that takes a parameter string of name, and this string we concatenated with this hello string so that the caller, in our case our person test, got returned a hello, and in our case hello Markus returned, and this we tested. Okay, so now I would like to talk about modifiers. First of all, about visibility modifiers. Actually, we already talked about them a bit. One visibility modifier is private. Another one is public. So public, I think I already said. This class is visible or usable from all other classes in all other packages. This class now resides on the package com, Markus Biel, Java course, lesson 2. So here, for example, name is in lesson 3. So if we would go in the code of the name class, it could easily use person, as long as it's public. A private class, we can try that. No, it says modifier private not allowed here. And of course, how would that make sense? I mean, a class that is not usable anywhere, but just in this class, this doesn't make sense. But actually, there is one more option. We can leave the modifier away, and this will give us the default modifier. This is also why it's called default modifier, or also package level modifier, because now person can only be used from other classes within this package. And we can do the same for the variables, the constructors. We can even have a private constructor. We could have that public. We could have that method private. And this one default. And we can even call, let's use this one. Let's call hello world from this method here. All this is working. And this actually even makes sense because especially when your methods are growing, I personally would say not more than 3 or 10 lines. Then to break things up, you can split a long method into smaller private methods and then calling the private method. Like, I mean, here we have only two methods. So to make things up, you can call one method 3 times, but of course I could define further methods. We don't have this now. And then you can call any number of methods later on. Okay, so to recap, visibility modifiers we learned so far is public, private, and default or package level. Besides, there are other visibility modifiers. One, for example, is protected, but we don't need this at the moment, so you should be perfectly coming along with just public, private, and default. So for now, let's just concentrate on these few. Let me fix the class shortly, because very soon we're going to need it in our test. And I don't want to adjust the test, I want to have the code as it was before. Okay, because now I would want to show you a new concept. I have this idea. I have prepared a test, should return number of persons. Let me create a few objects of type person. Person 1, person, person, person 2, let's do a new person. We could also use the other constructor, but then I would have to create an object of name, as this at the moment is just too much work for me, I'm not doing it. And I can also give it a different name, like my person, just to show you. We can have any name for the variables. So what this means is, when the test will be created, here, after this line is executed, which is just after the colon, we will have one object in memory, two objects in memory, and after this line, three objects in memory. So what I want now, I want to test on the number of objects. Now I should have 3 objects created. And I want to create a method that tells me exactly that, just dynamically. My person dot number of persons. Okay, still red, remember? We'll create it. And ta-da, int appeared. Because, I mean, 3 is a number, and a number in Java is an integer, or here in short, an int. An int is actually a primitive, and the default of this is 0. So this is why my IDE put 0 here. So it's not red anymore. We can have a first run, but this will not work, of course. Because it statically returns 0, we expect 3, so this is not what we want. Well, of course, we could say 3 statically. So now this should work. It's a bit cheating, of course. Green bar, ta-da. But I mean, I want this to dynamically work. So when I only have 2 persons, I want this to be 2. And well, of course, I have to rename my variable. Let's copy it. And now when I execute it, of course, this is not going to work. Expected 2, but it's still 3. So my first approach, the static one, always returning 3. Nice gag, but yeah, not what we need. So what we need is, at the specific time when each object is created, we need to count each object that is created. So what would be the place where the object is created? There is one thing similar to a method that is called And this is, you might guess it, the constructor. We used the default constructor for creation, so we would have to do something in here. Now, I want to invent a variable, an instance variable. I also call it, or let's call it person counter. Person counter equals to, and now I say person counter because I want the value it had before, and then I want to add 1 to the last value of person counter to have the new value dynamic. So on the left side is the new value, on the right side is still the value from the prior calculation, and I add 1 to it. Now this is a lot of code again, and this incrementation by 1 is used so often that they invented short form for that, which is plus plus. So with plus plus we say take the current value of person counter, increment it by 1, and save it again into the value of person counter. It's still red because we still have to create it. Let's do that. We make it private, of course. It's an int. I called it person counter and colon. Because I don't have to say 0, I could also say equals to 0, but the default for int is 0 anyway. So what we usually do is we just put it here as is. So the idea would be it starts with 0. The first time this constructor is called, it's incremented by 1, and so on. So that my method now should not statically return 3, but person counter instead. Okay, let's try that. Execute the method. Still not working, it returned 1. It didn't return 0. It didn't return 3, it returned 1. How is that? We didn't say 1 anywhere. Maybe you guessed it already. So we started with 0, we incremented by 1. Now I told you something in a prior session, which is this constructor is part of the instance. So each object has their own constructor, has their own method. So this is called for each of the objects. So in the end, both objects would have the counter set to 1. So what we need is more like a global counter that is not on the instance level, but we say on the class level. Because for all the objects of type person, there's only one class person. And this we achieve with a modifier called static. Okay, however, as a recommendation, because this will help you in the future, I won't go in details why, just believe me, as we have the variable of type static, you should also have the method of type static. It would work also without that, it's just better, believe me. Okay, so now let's execute it. And this works. Great. Let's try another thing. Let's add this time 4. 3 and 4. And 4. And execute it. And it works. I said actually person 2. Why not saying person 1? And it works. Well, as you see, this might be confusing. I mean, which variable to decide on? And also, there's a recommendation. Actually, what Java does is, Java sees that number of persons is a static method. It sees that you have an instance variable of type person. And as this is a static method, it doesn't call the method on the object because as this method is static, it's not part of the object anymore. This is like moving it out of the object. This method now is part of the class. So Java does some magic here, is trying to be smart and is smart, and calls the right method of the class. So what we're doing here is working because Java knows how to do it properly, but it's not so nice. What is better is directly saying person, so that everyone knows you're not going to any specific instance, you're just calling a static method on the person class. Let's execute that again. And it's working. Thank you. Thanks for watching. Please send feedback to info@marcus-biel.com. Bye.